to worship the Lord, worship in spirit and truth. Those who say that they know Him must walk as He walked. Those who worship the Lord, worship in spirit and truth. Those who say that they know Him must walk as He walked. He is the way and the truth, and in Him ends the life. If we obey His word, then we walk in the light.
This morning, saints. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. We thank God for this beautiful day that He has made.
Amen.
Last warm day of the week. Oh, hallelujah. The cold is coming tomorrow.
Yeah.
Tonight, tomorrow, next week,
and
this weekend.
Snow.
Chance of snow.
Yeah.
Tomorrow night. Mm-hmm. Winter remix. Maybe we'll get a little bit. Praise God. Father, thank You for this word today, and we just bless You. Bless You, Lord, for Your word. Thank You for Your word, Lord. Thank You for who You are. We just bless and praise Your holy name, Lord. We thank You for crushing down the enemy, O God, on behalf of Your church. Thank You, Jesus, for dying on the cross for us and rising from the dead. You're the mighty God, hallelujah, in the flesh. Oh, thank You, Jesus, for giving us the first resurrection right in our heart, O God, hallelujah. Jesus, You said to Martha that You are the resurrection. You said, I am the resurrection and the life. She was saying, oh, I know my brother's going to rise again on the last day. And You said, I am the resurrection and the life. Hallelujah. And Lord, we thank You that You live in us with Your resurrection power. We can walk in the light. We can walk in the truth. We can walk in love. Hallelujah. We can be other than this whole world is, Lord. Hallelujah. We can praise You and worship You and glorify You at every minute of every day. Hallelujah. No matter the trials, no matter what we're going through, we can love You and worship You and love one another. Thank You, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Keep us, oh God, and crush the devil under our feet. And it's in Your holy, precious name, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank You, Jesus. God is faithful.
He
never fails us. Never, ever, ever. Today's message has not denied my name. Okay? Now, the Lord is speaking to us here. It's in Revelation chapter 3, beginning at verse 7. And he's talking to the church in Philadelphia. Sharon, you want to read that? Beginning at verse 7.
And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, "These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and shutteth, and no man openeth."
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
"I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it, for thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name."
Hallelujah.
Boy, those two verses are just awesome, aren't they? Hey,
hallelujah.
If God opens a door,
no man is going to shut it. That's right.
If he shutteth the door,
no man can open it. Hallelujah. No amount of anything in this world is going to open a door that Jesus Christ has shut. I guarantee you.
And what does he say in the next verse? "I know thy works. Behold, I have set."
Before
this is
thee.
The Almighty God
Hallelujah.
Speaking. "I have set before thee an open door."
An open door. Oh, hallelujah.
"And no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength."
Now there we are.
See, he knows this.
That's right.
He knows sometimes we have little strength.
We have
strength,
a little strength.
Little strength.
Sometimes all the time we have a little strength.
But look here. "And has kept my word."
Amen. That's the key. That's a key. "Has kept my word." Hallelujah.
"And has not denied
my
name." See, the Lord knows our hearts, all of our hearts, through and through.
Let's comment on that a little bit. I want to go over here. My Bible, a certain part of my Bible is falling apart, but I can still use it. Praise the Lord. Well, I'm going to have to find it on the eSort. Okay, sorry about that.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, these are such awesome scriptures here, because when we know the Lord's opened a door for us, no matter how hard a man or entity tries to shut it,
right,
it's not going to be shut.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because God opened it. And he's the one that keeps it open as well. You know, I want to read these verses again.
Go ahead, read them again. That's good.
I really like these two verses.
Just read verse 7 and 8. Read verse 7 and 8.
"And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy."
He that is holy. He's set apart. He's holy. He's the Holy One of Israel.
"He that is true."
He's true. He's the truth. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Now, we're talking about the Almighty God in the flesh here, the Lord Jesus.
Yes.
Okay, he's speaking to his church. Okay, the word Philadelphia means brotherly love. Okay, and if you're from Philadelphia, they say, no, it means brotherly shove. Okay, no, it means brotherly love. That's what the word means. Okay, it's a word for love, Philadelphia.
"And he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth."
Okay, the key of David. The key of David. What is that key?
Well, the Lord is opening the door here.
Right.
He's speaking here. He's the one that hath the key of David.
Right. He has the key of David. Okay.
He's the one that's got the key that opens.
Right.
That opens it up.
Opens a door for the Holy Spirit to come to you. See, when Jesus died on the cross, he died there on the cross, and he went into the ground. He went into the netherworld, and he grabbed up all the saints that had went before, gathered them all in. You see, he took away the keys of death and hell from the devil, and he come out of the ground. He was resurrected in bodily form, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, okay? And it says in Matthew that many of those who had died came out of their graves, okay?
That's like a sign of his
resurrection.
Resurrection.
And so the key of David, that victory that Jesus, he says earlier in the book, he's the root and the offspring of David. Okay? See, he's the root and the offspring. So Jesus Christ, the key of David, is worship, praise, adoration, faithfulness to God. David was faithful in his house. That's what the word says. Hallelujah.
He also, the Lord, I believe, is telling us in this scripture that if he opens the door for us of whatever ministry or whatever in our life, if he opens that door, then no man can shut it.
That's right.
No man's
right.
going to shut that door.
Right.
I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door.
An open door. So he unlocked the open door.
Right, right. Hallelujah. He's got the keys.
That's right.
And no man can shut it, for thou hast a little strength, and has kept my word, and has not denied my name.
Has not denied his name.
In other words, in our words, in our life, in our actions, we have not denied his name.
Amen. Amen.
Because you can deny his name.
Thou hast a little strength.
Actions and in lifestyle or whatever, we can deny his
name.
That's
right. That's right.
But he knows those that haven't denied his name.
Right.
Hallelujah.
And you can repent if you deny his name in your actions. See, if you do that, if you fall, or if you just, because of stubbornness or rebellion, maybe, you know, because some of God's people are in rebellion, you know what I mean? And they just kind of kick against God. They kick against God. And God says, repent of that. See, you can come back, because the grace is still there to come back into the fold if you're a backslider today. And the Lord will receive you. You see what I mean? He's not going to turn you away if you have a broken and contrite heart. Amen?
Right, right.
He's not going to turn you away. I want to read this here. Thou hast a little strength. Now here's the Apostle Paul, 2 Corinthians 12:7. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure.
And sometimes he gives us that so that we won't be in a position to deny his name.
That's
in
right,
our life.
That's right.
Yeah.
And Paul said, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Thou hast a little strength.
Right.
See? In weakness. You're weak. You don't have any strength. Jesus says, his grace is sufficient for us, for his strength, is made perfect in our weakness. Okay?
Yes.
So let's don't focus on our weakness anymore. This is what Paul found out, see? Then Paul says, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me.
That's hard to do.
It is hard to do.
That's hard to do. But he's saying right here what the results of that is. You know, it's a good thing if we can do that.
That's right. Now listen to verse 10. 2 Corinthians 12:10. Therefore, Paul said, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses. Look at all these things he takes pleasure in.
Do we take pleasure in all these things?
No,
we don't. That's hard to do. What does he say, pleasure? What does pleasure mean on that?
And here it is right here, pleasure. To think well of. Approve.
Oh.
Okay? To think well of. To be pleased. Mm. Pleasure. Be willing. Okay? Be willing. There's one we can stand on. Be willing. If we're going through a trial, be willing. Say, Lord, you know what you're doing here. I'm going to trust you. I'm not going to kick against you, Lord. I'm not going to covet against the way. I'm going to trust you, Lord. I'm going to say, I know you're going to bring us through. See? Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities. In infirmities, reproaches, necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. For when I am weak, then am I strong. Okay? In other words, because we're weak, we're totally just throwing our life upon the Lord and saying, Lord, you got to do it. You got to make this leg move today. See what I mean? You need to do it. And the Lord does it. Whatever your weakness might be, God says he can come in. He wants to come in and quicken your mortal body. Where
Amen.
You're not weak, where you can't get off the couch, but you can get off the couch. You can do what needs to be done today. God does that in us and through us.
You know, a good prayer to pray, and I pray it every morning before the broadcast. I say, Lord, empower us.
That's good.
Empower us to speak your word and your truth, and put your words in our mouth. You know, you can pray that even for what's going on in your life. Lord, empower me with the strength to go through this.
Amen.
Empower me with your love and your grace and your mercy.
Your wisdom. To endure. Everything. Hallelujah.
What your will is, Lord. And if this is not your will, what's going on with me, if this is not a burden that you have put on me, then I ask you to take it off.
Right. Crush wherever it's coming from.
A lot of times, you know, we have a video out there that's Satan's burden.
Right.
And Satan's burden is the past and things that...
No, his cross is the past and his burden is the future.
Right, okay.
Satan's future. Burden, yeah.
But sometimes he can put a burden on us that God didn't give us.
That's right.
To bear. If God gives us a burden to bear about something or someone or whatever, we're going to be able to bear it because he said that in his word, and he's Amen. Not a liar.
Amen.
But sometimes, and we have found this even in our own experience, that the enemy will put a burden there that you can't bear.
Right.
You cannot. And you know why? Because God didn't give it to you to bear.
Amen.
And there's been many times when we prayed, Lord, if this is not from you, lift it off of us. And he did lift it off of us.
Hallelujah.
You know why? Because it wasn't from him.
Right.
It was something that maybe someone else is trying to throw on you in the spirit.
Or someone will speak to you.
Whatever.
Someone will speak to you something and it will really bring you down.
Right.
See.
You don't, into the slot.
Right. You don't have to bear that burden.
Right,
see.
Right.
You just go forward in the Lord. Yeah. You say, well, praise the Lord. Keep going forward. See.
Yeah.
And you don't listen to that. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now back to where I was over here. I gotta get back there. No, that's not where I was. Over here. Here we go. Okay. Hallelujah. Back to Revelation 3. In verse number 7. Oh, I way passed it up. We're talking about the church in Philadelphia today, because I'm telling you right now, we've experienced this. When I came back to the Lord in 1994, Thanksgiving Day, I found my old Bible, and I had a New American Standard Catholic Version Bible at the time, and I've since, the Lord told us to get a King James, so that's what we read today. But I opened up the Bible there, I was sitting on the couch, and I opened it right to Revelation chapter 3, in verse 7, to the church in Philadelphia. And I read that. All those verses. We're going through them right now. And the Lord spoke in my spirit. He said, that's you. That's what he told me. This is for you. This is for you. I said, thank you, God. Thank you. I just was weeping like a baby because, you know, God had mercy on me. I mean, saints, we don't even know really the filthiness and the magnitude of sin and the blight, just the wickedness of it, the affront of sin that here we are
to God.
And you know, mm-hmm. we're in the bowels of Adam, you know, and then here we are in this beautiful garden that God created, just so beautiful, and the tree of life right there, and all the fruit that was there, everything beautiful. And they just shoved their fist in God's face and said, no, I don't want it. You see, that's what sin is.
Yeah, I
want
to listen to the serpent instead.
I want to be God, you know. I don't want to be subservient to anybody, you know. And we can do that in our walks where we fall away from God because God told us to do something hard, you know.
Right.
Or God told us we were having such a fun time over here and God told us, I don't want you to do that no more. I want you to go over here and work. And where he's sending us is like hard, you know. We go, oh God, I don't, you know. And we can do that today, even with the Holy Spirit inside. We can still say no to God. That's sad, but it happens. the flesh rises up and says no to God. But see, God says, I want you to get past that. You see what I'm saying? Because he'll let you. If he tells us to do something and we don't want to do it, he'll say, okay, go ahead. Do what you want to do then. And you go do what you want to do for 2 or 3 months, and it's like, oh, God, you know, everything's going wrong. You're having problems, blah, blah, blah. And he says, now, are you ready to come back? Because, see, he's always right there. He's always right there. With me for 9 years, running from God, just run away from God. Went deeper and deeper. It was just a downhill slope all the way into the pit. I mean, it was just bad. But he was always there, ready to take me back, right there.
Rebellion is always the way of death.
It is.
It always is.
He took me back. He took me back. I mean, I'm telling you, he can take any backslider back. Praise God.
Repentance brings life.
That's right.
It brings the life back in.
That's right.
You know.
Hallelujah.
And, I mean, you know when you're doing wrong, and you know when you're going against the Lord.
Right, right.
Because you can feel that death, you know, mm-hmm. You can feel that,
you
know, inside. But then when you get back in the flow of the right, the flow of life, you can also feel that.
Right.
So life flows, the river flows. The other direction is stagnant.
Right.
Doesn't move, stays in the same position. Year after year after
it's
year.
It's a swamp.
Yeah.
It's just a...
So it's not a going forward at all. It's staying right where a person's at, you know. And yeah, the Lord will let you do that. Until you get so sick of it that you cry out to God, change me, Lord.
Remember what he showed us years ago about the dam of unforgiveness. The dam of holding a grudge. The dam of... All these different things that Christians do, unfortunately, they're like a dam, and it just blocks the river from flowing. So if you block the river from flowing, what happens? It just starts getting stagnant, just mm-hmm. like you're saying. Mm-hmm. And the fish can't
and
get no water.
Can
and
even
disease
start
can come
too,
in.
Yeah.
And so when you forgive, it breaks the dam mm-hmm. where the water can flow.
Right.
See? And when you say, Lord, forgive me for holding a grudge against that guy for 3 years, you know, it just breaks the dam. See?
That's clean water.
Yeah.
Water that flows.
Right. Right.
So if you watch a little place where the water is dammed up, and you can see over time, it will start to change color.
Right. Right.
You know, and that's just it changes color because there's junk going on in it. It starts to get moldy.
Right.
Algae stinks. Now see, that's a spiritual thing too. We can start to stink,
right?
You know, spiritually,
right?
Because we're staying in it, man. Staying in the stagnant place.
Right. We don't want to.
No.
Let's repent.
No, the Lord says that. You know, we pray. You know, when we see people in that position, we just pray, Lord. Whatever you have to do to bring them to their knees in a true repentance, I pray that you do that. And you can pray that too.
Right.
Because the Lord hears our prayers.
Right.
Amen. And it's not just a one-time prayer either. You keep praying till the answer comes. You keep persevering until the answer comes.
Praise God.
Because, you know, there's things that's God's job alone, and that's one of them.
Praise
repentance
God.
Is his job. To bring
Amen.
That to people. We can't do that. We may be able to speak the truth, and the Spirit of God may quicken or, you know, his sword may go in and bring that conviction, but repentance is not our job. It's God's job.
Amen. Look at verse 9. Now read verse 9, dear.
Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. Hallelujah. You know, that's actually happened in our
life. I know, man. Let me tell
you
the
story. It's actually happened in our life.
This, this was right before we got into a house, and we were staying with these people that had a house they were renting, and these people started to come against us, and
big time.
We were like, man, why does this happen all the time?
I
you know?
Know,
And all we do is just love people. We were having Bible studies and everything, man. It was just beautiful.
It's speaking the truth, and the truth is hard sometimes.
We were discerning some things, surely, you know, that were going on in these people's lives, but we weren't blasting them or nothing. We were just fellowshipping, but behind the scenes, they were coming against us. And then they had this plan to leave us hanging, to leave us high and dry, you see? And God told me, me and Sharon, they said they were moving. And so me and Sharon were like, well, usually when God's moving us, he starts preparing us 2 or 3 weeks in advance.
But he wasn't.
You know? And he wasn't. We were just sitting there just as calm as everything. Just, okay, praise the Lord. And the
okay,
Lord showed
Lord,
me what to do.
Want?
But the day that they left, this guy blew up. He just literally lost and blew up. And he was really coming against us and coming against Sharon and coming against me. And he was talking to Sharon, and because, see, Sharon has this gift that God's given her of discernment. It's a very precious gift. And she can discern, you know, about things and about what's going on with people. And she knows. And so the Lord gives her this gift, and she speaks to people, you know, what the Lord shows her. And she's not afraid to do that. And so she had spoken to this guy several times about things, and he just didn't like the fact that she was so outspoken, really. You know, he was just more angry and angry every day. And some men are like that. They're just like male chauvinists, you can call them, or whatever. You know, women aren't supposed to speak. Women are, you know, stay in the kitchen or whatever. And, well, Sharon is a woman of God who God has called her and given her gifts. And so she wants to operate in those gifts, and she should, and she does. Well, anyway, this guy, he ended up just... this guy weighed almost 400 pounds. We were just standing there, just both of us looking at each other. He fell down on the ground, just bam, and he started just going up and down on the ground, literally, right in front of Sharon. And the word says,
in a worship mode,
I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews. They say they're Christians, but they're not, okay? But do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet. And to know that I have loved thee. And
well,
love there is agapeo. That's the action.
That happened that day. We were, John and I were looking at each other like.
I just looked at Sharon and put my hand on her shoulder. I said, whew, man. We were just real quiet. And then they left, didn't they?
Yeah.
And so what did we do? We went over to the landlord. We knew the landlord. And we told him we want to rent the house.
And
God gave us the money.
The
we just gave him the first month.
It was like, wow.
There was not even a misstep in the ministry or nothing.
No.
Everything just kept flowing. Yeah. We got in this house. It was totally empty.
Yeah.
It was totally empty, man.
Well, there was one chair, and that was it. Yeah.
But we were like out of the motorhome into this big old house. And we were like, whoa, this is awesome.
It was huge, too.
Yeah,
like 3,000 square feet or
something. No, it wasn't 3,000.
How big was it?
It was almost 2,000 square feet.
2,000. Well, it was real big for us.
But it was big for us from 150 to that. Man. But anyway, the Lord just, we say this because, see, we don't want to deny Jesus. We don't want to deny his name. Now, listen, you can have lots of friends. You can have lots of notoriety. You can get on any bandwagon you want to get on, okay, and have lots of people following you or surrounding you or whatever. But what are you denying to get all that? See?
Right.
Most people who have large followings have denied, compromised in some area, okay? They don't hold to the truth. They won't preach the cross. They won't preach the self-denial life, okay? They won't, because that turns people away. Nobody wants to do that,
right.
See? Jesus said, red letters, if you don't deny you have to deny yourself daily, take up your cross daily, or you're not even worthy to be my disciple. See?
Well, we also have to remember in the word where the Lord says, he doesn't say it's big, large, giant crowds, does he?
Mm-mm. Few there be that find it.
He says, the Lord Jesus Christ says, few there be that find it. Okay, what's his idea of few? Well, I can tell you in Noah's day, it was 8.
Man.
Okay? In Noah's day, it was 8. The Lord God Almighty says, few there be that find it. He doesn't say a large,
multitude
is going to find it. He says few.
And what we're seeing in the world today is this whole Antichrist system, see, making man God. Mm-hmm. Okay, and man is not God. There is a man who is God. He is at the Father's right hand right now, the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. He is God in the flesh, okay? He is in a resurrected body, okay? And if he walked into your living room today and said, here, stick your hand in my side, I guarantee you'd be on the floor weeping and crying. And if he said, put it in his side, you better get to putting it in there so you can be a believer like Thomas, okay? Because Thomas didn't believe, but then he said, I had to see. And so Jesus came to him, and he thrust his hand into his side.
He had to see.
He had to see to believe.
Before he would believe.
And Jesus said, blessed are they who have not seen and yet have believed.
Yet have believed. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Now, we
want to... That's a big lesson for all of us.
Oh, I'm telling you. We need to remember his word, see? But he said, behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews. So if this happens to you, don't be shocked. We were kind of, whoa. We were all the time thinking this is later on, you know. But it happened that day. We were like, whoa.
Man.
But he says they're liars. They lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. Verse 10, because thou hast kept the word of my patience. The word of my patience. You haven't failed to speak about the Lord. You haven't failed to preach my gospel. You haven't failed to persevere through the battle, through the time, a hard time. Okay? Because thou hast kept the word of my patience. This is for all those in the remnant who have not failed to keep his word. See? To walk with him and to say, Lord, I need you. Every day, you see what I'm saying? We're walking with the Lord. He says, we've kept the word of his patience, see? We have not denied his name. I also will keep thee. That's what he says. You've kept my word. You've not denied my name. He says, I also will keep thee.
That's a promise.
That's right. From the hour of testing, temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. To try them that dwell upon the earth. See, they're trying it with democracy. They're trying it with communism. They're trying it with Islam. They're trying it with Buddhism. They're trying it with Roman Catholicism, Masonic worship of Baal. They're trying it all these different ways. They're trying to make it in. Trying to go up some other way. Jesus Christ said, I am the door. Okay? All who hear my voice, follow me.
All the circumstances that are created in this day, in this hour, there's a testing time.
That's what we're in, isn't it?
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
And it's greater than any testing time that ever has been or ever will be. The Bible says so. And that's the reason right now the Lord is getting his people prepared. Those that are willing to be prepared, he is getting them prepared for the time to come. And really, we're in. Because you can tell more and more that the enemy is looking for any little tiny minute thing that he can grab a hold of in our life. And we have to be seeking the Lord and staying so close to him in this hour. Say, Lord, you purge out of me everything that's not of you. You know, the devil, what is he? He was always pride. Trademark of pride.
Right.
So what does he try to do with God's true children in circumstances? He's very sneaky. He'll come in and try to put this thought or something of elevation. Elevation.
Mm-hmm.
In our minds,
right.
You know, a thought or whatever. We have to throw out every type of thing like that at all, because the Lord, none of his walk was a walk of elevation.
Right. It was humble.
None of it.
Humble yourself.
None of his walk was
Hallelujah.
Elevation at all.
Hallelujah.
In his actual walk on the earth, in his mind, in his speech, none of it was elevation. All of it was humble and lowly. And he is our example.
Praise his holy name.
We have to throw down, cast down all things such as that. and not let it take even a minute nanosecond in our mind.
Let me read this. You just said that. I got to read this out of 1 Peter chapter 5. And Peter says here, you just talked about that. He says in verse 6, humble yourselves therefore, 1 Peter 5, 6, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that in due time, that he may exalt you in due time. Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him. For he careth for you. Isn't that beautiful?
See? Can we do that?
Yes, we can.
Can we cast all our care upon him?
Yes, we can.
Or do we reserve part of it to just stay in the sloth, so to speak?
Well, sometimes we do that too.
Yeah.
But
so
we don't
want
to. We can cast all our care
upon
him.
That's what he wants us to do.
All right, amen.
So if you cast it all on him and cry out to him, pour out your heart to him, he understands it all through and through. There's no one that understands like him.
That's right.
Nobody you could talk to
will
understand like the Lord Jesus Christ.
You're saying that, and I can see Jesus in my mind's eye. Just, and, you know, we're giving him our excuses, or we're giving him our whatever. You know, we're casting it on him, our cares. And then when he looks at you, he just kind of grins a little bit, you know. And then you realize, oh, really, that's right, Lord, it's nothing, isn't it?
Yeah, because when you pour your heart out like that.
It's in the mind, the elevation that you see. And then, in other words, there's a wall to go over, okay? And the wall is actually 3 feet high. But in our mind, we paint the wall 100 feet high. See what I mean? This is impossible, Lord. And the Lord's looking at us like, oh, you know, look at it through my eyes. And when we do, we see, oh, I can just step over that. Okay, see?
You know, when we go to the Lord, and we really do go to the Lord, and we really do cast everything on him, and we pour our heart out to him, well, I'll just tell you something that kind of funny happens. As we're speaking out to the Lord and everything, all this stuff that's all in our mind and we're so troubled by and everything else, as we're speaking it and crying out to him about it, there's something that takes place there a lot of times. That he just kind of shows us, this is really not a big a deal as you're making it,
right?
Is it? This is really not a big a mountain as you're making it, is it? And he tends to turn it around and show us really how small it is.
Right.
And we just have to kind of chuckle, because he has a way of doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And then he has a way in those things to show us our heart. And sometimes he shows us just what a spoiled brat we can be.
Right.
Just spoiled. And not wanting any hard time, and not wanting anything hard in our life, and not wanting any thing to hurt us in our life, or anything like that. When most of the time, the way the Lord grows us up is through circumstances of pain and of suffering.
Right. Inconvenience.
In one way or the other.
Right.
Not necessarily physical suffering, but it can be.
Right. I want to look this word up, dwell, here in the last part of this verse, 9, verse 10, Revelation 3. Dwell means to house permanently, reside, literally or figuratively, okay, inhabitant, you know. Those that dwell. It's going to try them. See, he's going to keep us because we have kept the word of his patience. He says, I also will keep thee. Now listen, saints. He says, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Okay. Now, right now, he says judgment begins in the house of the Lord. It's happening right now with his saints, you see. He's really doing some deep work in all of us, where he's taking out the bad, you know, and doing away with it. Crucify the flesh, where his life can flow through us, okay? Are we saying it's going to be easy street? No, it's not going to be easy street, but it's the Lord's street, and that's the sure street, that you're going to make it on. You see what I'm saying? Right. It's not the broad way, okay? It's the Lord's way. Hallelujah.
It's not the road everybody else is taking.
Right. Exactly.
It's the road few take.
Hallelujah. So praise God. And then he says, go to verse 11, dear. Read verse 11. This is so beautiful. Verse 11 and 12.
Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown.
Now let's talk about that a little bit.
I think he's showing us there.
I need to look that up. Hold that fast. Okay. Krateo, to use strength, to seize or retain. There are times when a sharp rebuke is necessary because really, like for instance, if someone talks to us in a certain way, and it's different with all of, you know, wherever you are, what you're going through, whatever today. But sometimes a real strong rebuke is necessary because someone's trying to steal your crown, you know.
Right.
You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Or it might be doubling up on the prayer. Sometimes God doesn't have you say anything to somebody, okay, when you recognize things might be happening. He doesn't have you say anything to that person, but just double up in the prayer, you see.
What does crown mean there?
You know, that no man take thy crown. Yep. Hallelujah.
Thy royalty.
It's a symbol of honor.
Honor.
See?
Yeah.
A symbol of honor, a prize, as a badge of royalty. Oh, praise God. No man take thy crown. See? He said he comes quickly. He said, hold that fast which thou hast. Okay? Hold it fast. I'm going to look that up because I want to see. Oh, I already did. Okay. You got to hold it. You got to hold the faith. You got to stand in the faith. Hallelujah. That no man take your crown. Verse 12, dear.
You know, it's coming to me too. A lot of times, you know, I forget who it was. I think it was T. Austin Sparks, but it was talking about being in the company of people that are always doubtful.
Mm-hmm.
Always pulling down your faith.
Right, right.
And, you know, he says, you know, there comes a time when you have to not be in their company because
right.
then you begin to be pulled down yourself.
Right.
And in this hour right here, you really don't want to be in the company of someone that's going to constantly pull you down spiritually.
Right.
Pull your faith down, make you doubt everything. I'll never forget it. One place the Lord sent us. And we were at this lady's place, and I was always speaking to her about the Lord. And I mean, every time I would say a positive thing about the Lord, she would turn around with a doubtful thing out of her mouth and try to pull my faith down every time. And I threw it off really fast. I said, no, this is what the Word of God says, and this is what I'm going to stand on. See, because if you entertain that, if you entertain what someone like that is saying to you, it begins to take a toll on you.
Amen.
And it can pull you down into the same kind of mindset as they have.
Right.
So you just have to separate yourself from that.
Amen. That's right.
In order for you to go on spiritually,
that's right.
You have to separate yourself from that.
Praise God.
And it's going to be real important more and more in this time we're going in.
That's right.
So,
hallelujah. God is so faithful. Verse 12.
Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God. And he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God. And the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name.
Hallelujah.
That is awesome. Yeah. You see right here, the Lord is saying, I'm going to do this.
Right.
I will write upon him the name or the character of my God.
That's right.
And how can he do that? He wants us to walk the walk in the character of the Lord Jesus
right.
Christ.
It's a spiritual
it's
etching.
Spiritual.
I mean, he's writing it right now. See, we don't see that, really. We don't pay no attention to it. We see these, I mean, look in the spirit. He's writing it right now. He's forming it right now, see? See, there's one rule operates in the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of glory, and that's love. There's three things that last: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. See, love, what does it do? It suffers long, see? It is kind. See what I mean? It thinketh no evil. See what I mean? Love. That's what Paul said. Okay, agape. And, you know, the Lord is agape. See? Praise God. So that's just, I don't want to take too much of a rabbit trail off of that, but that's just the truth. I mean, he's writing in us right now the name of
the character,
the authority of his God. Hallelujah. The Father.
Know, we really need to pray, Lord, really imprint your character in our hearts and your love in our hearts, your true love in our hearts. And whatever you have to do, Lord, to do that, do it, you know, to really embed that in us.
And then he says the name of the city of God, which is New Jerusalem. That's powerful. We need to dig into that more. And then he says, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. Okay? Now, he's going to get a new name. My new name. This is so deep. You know, I don't even want to scratch the surface. I mean, you know what I mean? Because it's sometimes the Lord shows you things. It's hard to communicate in the English language. You just have to have it in the spirit, you know. Mm-hmm. Remember that guy we met when we were doing that Rosicrucian's house? And this guy was a Messianic Jew, a Messianic Christian. And he said, God speaks Hebrew. God talks in Hebrew. I said, man, God speaks spirit, man, spirit, okay? Those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And that's the truth. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. That is the truth.
Amen.
So look at this. Hast not denied my name. And so let us today, let's ask the Lord to help us, to show us anywhere at all that we maybe are denying his name. Okay? I don't want to deny his name. See? And I don't believe I have denied his name. I know I had in the past, but all that's forgiven. Okay? So today we want to seek the Lord and say, Lord, show us anywhere where we are denying you. If we are, Lord, show us. You see, we can't be so prideful and say, you know, that I'm not capable to deny his name. I'm telling you right now, he can put the screws on a person.
Well, like God Peter, can. He didn't think he was capable.
That's right.
But he did.
He did. And the Lord can, he's very loving, and he knows what his children need today. But he tailor makes everything we go through. He knows how much we can bear. And he says, I will never give you more than you can bear. But with it, I will make a way of escape. Hallelujah. Now, how many times have we found that to be true?
Amen.
And he made a way, boy.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Let's pray. Lord, thank you today. Lord, thank you so much. I worship you. We worship you, Lord. We adore you, Jesus. We thank you for this word. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we want to pray right now for every believer, everyone who hears this word today. Lord, you know every single part of their being, spirit, soul, and body. You know what's going on in their life, Father. We pray, Lord, that they would hear your voice, that we would all hear your voice clearly, unequivocally, Lord, that you would block out and crush and demolish every other voice today, Lord, but your voice coming to us, speaking to us in our inner man, showing us great and mighty things, Lord. Hallelujah. We want you, Jesus. We want to walk in your way, to talk in your way, to love in your way, and to prophesy in your way, Lord Jesus, and to speak your words one to another. Words of life. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, do your work in us. Do your work in us, Lord, by your cross. And let us walk today in that resurrection life of power that you are at the Father's right hand. Send down your chief princes, Lord, to surround us, to protect us from all evil, and to shield us from all attacks of the enemy, O God. Be that wall of fire around us, O Lord. Hallelujah. And crush the devil's head under our feet in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to the King. Amen. Hallelujah. God is good, faithful, and just. Praise God.
If you want to contact us, you can contact us at the King's Road 2000 at gmail.com. The King's Road 2000 at gmail.com. And since we're going to put this up on YouTube, you can go to the links below and it will have a link to click on to come and listen to the broadcast live Monday through Friday.
On Spreaker.
And then it also has a link where you can download the MP3 of this broadcast. And then further down it has all of the blogs, and which will take you to all the MP3 sites and YouTube channels and everything else. So there's a lot of word out there, a lot that will bless you and challenge you, and prayerfully, if you need conviction, convict you.
Amen.
So it's really important in this hour to really get doused in the Word of God.
Amen.
So that we will not be even tempted to get into error.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Because the more you look at, you know, just like they said in the bank, you know, the example in the bank. How do you know whenever you come across a fake bill? Well, they said, we work so much with real money.
The tellers, they train them with real money.
Yeah, with real money, that they automatically know when they come across a fake bill. And that's just the same principle spiritually. The more true word that we get in us, douse our minds with it, wash our minds with it. It says washing of the word. The word washes our mind.
Amen.
So the more that we have that, the
we'll
more we're going to know.
False.
We're going to recognize
right.
the false. If we turn on something or click on a video or whatever, we're going to automatically recognize when we're hearing falsity.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
So that's real important in this hour. Boy, you don't want to get on the wrong train, because false teachers and false prophets will have their reward, will have their judgments, their end. But the Bible also says those that follow them, that seek unto them, will have the same reward as they do.
Hmm. That's a good one, boy. I need to remember that. All of us do.
That is just very important,
Amen.
You guys. I mean, that's the Word of God. That's not something John and Sharon pulled out of the air. That's what the Bible says.
Amen.
And you know what? It doesn't matter if you want to throw the Bible out and don't believe the Bible. It still stands.
That's right.
And it's still the truth.
Amen.
And it's still going to come to pass.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise His holy name. We want you to have a blessed day, and so we always end the broadcast with the blessing that God told Aaron. Moses told Aaron to bless the people. So that's how we end this broadcast, and I know that's the way the Lord wants to end it each day. Also, I want to make a comment about we're in the process of praying for what we need to get a couple of apps. What are those? For the cell phones or whatever.
Yeah,
for the
special apps.
Android
for this
and
broadcast.
iOS.
This,
yeah,
for,
just
this
for
broadcast.
This broadcast that people can put on their phone. A lot of people listen on their phones. So that's good. Praise the Lord. And God will provide for that. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. The Lord bless you and keep you and make His holy face to shine upon you. The Lord our God lift up His holy countenance on you and grant you peace. Hallelujah. The Lord be gracious unto you. May His face be shining on you today with the authority and the character and His name in and through your life in Jesus' name. Amen. Glory to the King. Have a blessed day today, saints. Hallelujah.